items and clothing to make sure that the COVID are protected at all times, especially if they're in the room. And also the old mobile phones, can you either put them on sound, which is one of the things you want. Okay. Apologies for absence. We have from Councillors Dean Stapleton, Chris Meaden and Paul Tweed. Any other apologies? No? Okay, can I welcome Jane Kennedy, the Police Department Commissioner, to her first meeting? Welcome, Jane. I hope that you find all these things are quite informal. And, you know, any opportunity you wish to ask any questions, please feel free. I'm sure you have a wealth of knowledge in your capacity as the PCC and former Member of Parliament and Government Minister, so I'm sure it would be beneficial for us to have your comments and observations for any of the items that we have on our agenda as we go forward.
Can I just ask the grey to turn to red?
Okay, so is there any declarations of interest from any members or officers on any items on the agenda? No? And there's no massive urgency to be considered. The exempt items is item agenda 11 and item 12. We'll have to ask for the present public to leave the room, if that's okay. Thank you very much. Also, at this point, can I just pass on members' thanks for Bill and to Sid and to all those officers and staff who put together the Christmas card service that we had in St. Nick's Church was last week. I think everybody who attended, it's always a lovely event to attend. The service was always well attended. I think this year was more attended than expected, actually. It was a good turnout. And I think it was a lovely service from the choir to the kids in the school singing. I think it was absolutely fantastic. And it set you in the mood, doesn't it, to the festivities ahead. So if we could be called on, thanks and appreciation to all our staff who put that together, that would be hard. Okay, item two is the minutes from the previous meeting. Did they agree? Any issues? No. Item three is the statement of assurance. Can I ask the Chief Justice?
Thank you, Chair. Members, the purpose of this report is to request that you approve the statement of assurance, which is attached to the covering report of Appendix A, and that's on pages 15 through 235 of your meeting papers. As members will be aware, the authority is required to provide assurance to government on financial, governance and operational matters and to show how that we've met the expectations as set out within our integrity risk management plan. That responsibility is discharged through the publication of an annual statement of assurance. The substantive point for members to be aware of is that the statement of assurance is backward looking and covers the financial year 2016-17. Contents page on page 16 lists the key headings within the statement of assurance. So I'm not going to go through those in any detail. What I will say, members, is that forward to the statement of assurance, which is on page 17, sets out the financial context within which the authority operates and therefore serves as a sense check to the readers. So to be very clear about that, what I've set out there in that forward is the fact that we are delivering the service against the backdrop of some very extreme cuts to the budget, and that has an inevitable consequence. It's very important that is set out front and centre for the reader to understand that. I'll pause at that point, members, to take any questions that you might have.
Okay, thanks. Thank you. Any questions or comments from members? Are we happy to approve that? No, yeah. Okay, thank you very much. Also.
You didn't say if I had any questions. Just on page 31, I'll just have a quick word with the Chief on the way into the meeting. And he assures me that the typos are the internal auditors' typos. But on the top of page 31, the statement from the annual review of the internal audit report, if that is how it does appear, it needs to be taken back to them. They need to be invited to proofread what they publish, because I've got six significant misspellings and mistypos. So it's just, from the point of view of public perception, it is, I think, important that that be correct.
Item 4 is the financial review for the last 6 months. Thanks, Chair. This report covers the revenue and capital budgets, reserves and treasury management performance updates for April to September 2017. Paragraph 9 and 10 on page 39 to 40 advises members that all the approved revenue budget saving options, bar the 1% firefighter pay assumption, are expected to be delivered this year. The firefighters were offered a 2% pay increase this year, but this has been rejected. Negotiations are ongoing, but it's highly unlikely the pay increase will be settled at the 1% assumed in the budget. For each additional 1% pay increase, the authority will have to identify permanent additional annual savings of approximately £300,000. The authority has established a £500,000 inflation reserve to meet any in-year inflationary increases above those assumed in the budget. The report assumes any additional firefighter pay award in 2017-18 will be met from the inflation reserve, and that the 2018-19 budget process will consider how any additional increase can be permanently funded. Paragraph 11 to 13 on pages 40 to 42 outlines the expected year-end revenue position, and a £900,000 favourable position has been forecast. In light of the uncertainty over the current firefighter and future employee pay awards, the report recommends members approve the utilisation of this favourable variance to fund an increase in the existing smoothing reserve. The smoothing reserve would then allow the authority time to react to any change in the plan's pay assumptions in order to identify and implement the required savings to maintain a balanced financial position. Pages 42 to 44 outline the amendments to the approved capital programme of just under £0.4 million, of which the majority relates to ICT expenditure required on the new ES-MCP radio control project and is fully funded by Home Office grant monies. At the end of September, the authority held just under £40 million worth of investments, but this includes £28.7 million firefighter pension grant that will be utilised in the year. A breakdown of the investments is contained on the table on page 46. All investments are consistent with the approved investment strategy and within the limits outlined in paragraph 22 on page 46. No new loans have been taken out in the year. But members are asked to approve the utilisation of the £900,000 forecast revenue saving. An increase in the smoothing reserve in light of the increasing risk around the 1% pay award assumption for firefighters in the current budget. I'm happy to take any questions on the report. Thanks. Any questions, Barbara?
Thanks, Chair. On page 416, I just would like some clarity around this table, because would I be right in thinking a AAA rating is very good?
Yeah.
And therefore, a single A rating is less good, and unrated is even less good. Pardon my English language there. In which case, my question would be, wouldn't we be wiser to put all of the investment in AAA ratings, and why have we not done that?
Yeah, it's a very good question. What we said when we approved the budget is a treasury management strategy. What I've tried to highlight at the top of that page is the limits that we place on, because you're right in saying that the higher rated, the less risk. In reality, though, as you can see, I think from those tables, at the building societies that aren't AAA listed, there is still a certain degree of protection because they are a building society. And what we do is we use Liverpool City Council's Treasury Management Department, and they have access to numerous consultants and other reports to ensure that, like, if the Icelandic bank situation came about, they would be hopefully aware of that and wouldn't be investing in any A-rated building society that was at risk at all. There's always going to be a risk, and we do place security as the priority, but we are trying to see to get as much yield as we can from those investments.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. It's more of a comment than a question, but it's just basically to say that given the very difficult financial circumstances of the Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority have to operate under, as I read this report overall, it's a very positive report, and I just think we should, you know, give credit to Ian and all the other staff involved in this for the way they're managing the finances in a very difficult situation. Thank you, Jerry.
It's just to add to what Ian said. As he pointed out, we do as an authority have an arrangement with Liverpool City Council for the Treasury Management. And I will just point out that Liverpool City Council actually uses B-rated investments as well. So if anything, the Fire and Rescue Authority is more prudent than the City Council when it comes to investments. I did have a question about the Bank of England base rate increase. Do you know if that's had any impact on the Public Works loan board rates, or if it's likely to have any sort of impact on the borrowing costs?
There is, I think it's in the Treasury Management section, a comment on where we think the Public Works loan board rates will go. You would have expected, as the Bank of England base rate goes up, then obviously there would be a link to the Public Works loan board. What we try and do is, at the moment, it's cheaper for us to use internal cash and reduce the investments, but we constantly monitor that situation. So what we'll be looking to do in reconciling our capital programme and our future borrowing requirements, start to ask the question, is it better to borrow money at a lower rate now, even though we might not need it for a year or two, than wait a year or two and find out there's been a 1 percentage point increase. And so it's an exercise about, and we do work closely with Liverpool, about trying to forecast where the Public Works loan board rates will be against our need over the next 2, 3, 4 years, against using internal cash as a better way of funding the short term of that investment.
Thanks, Chair. I fully endorse what's been said about the way that the budget is being managed, and I appreciate this is a reassurance document about the partway through the year and to reassure that everything is well. I, from my perspective from the police, we have a budget of 307 million and a reserves that total about 30 million, 12 million of which are the contingency reserve. This being my first meeting, I appreciate I might be asking questions that have already been answered, but we get, we have government ministers repeatedly saying the police have plenty of money if they simply use their reserves. The ministers know that isn't true. I've actually written to ministers to ask if there are any reserves held by Merseyside Police that they think we should spend. Could they please tell me? Because they are all, as you know, you're not here. I just wondered, your total reserves are around about the same as ours. How do we explain that to the public, and what is the explanation for that? I know, I mean, this isn't meant as a criticism, it's simply to hear what we say as a fire authority, because I know what we say as a police, whatever I'm called, police commissioner. I know that I have an explanation for it, but I find it constantly puts us on the back foot when I'm trying to campaign for more resources. And I'm sure you have answers to this. It's just I haven't heard them. I'd really appreciate the chance to hear them, if that's okay.
Yeah, I mean, we have a similar challenge from government departments about the same type of question. And it's a bit perverse in the sense that because of the financial crisis we're facing, and it's a year-on-year reduction in our government support, we're having to put money in reserve to meet commitments that we won't have to be able to fund from our revenue budget. The best example we have is
Appendix A4, there's a full list there of all the reserves. And what you'll see, the biggest single reserve we have is the capital investment reserve. That currently starts about the, nearly 17 million, it's getting down now to 11 million. That's being used to fund the station merger programme and TGA refurbishment. What we're trying to do is avoid borrowing, because roughly 10% of our revenue budget is committed to supporting historic borrowing. So what we're trying to do is control that longer term growth in a greater proportion of our revenue budget being used to support the servicing of debt. So we're quite clear in that we can explain all of these areas. We're trying to do the Appendix A4 and give you a breakdown, but that is the biggest single reserve we have, and it's about reducing the need to borrow, which will have a long term commitment to service that debt when we've got a reducing budget. So each of those reserves we can justify in turn, and there's another one we have, for example, is a recruitment reserve that we know we're going to lose probably 300 firefighters over the next 4 to 5 years. So although our budget's finite in terms of our employee establishment, we use that reserve to recruit in advance so we can get those recruits up to speed, and so before the competent firefighters leave, we don't need to replace them. So we can go through each one in turn and think and meet the challenge. We also include in the statement of accounts that we have to produce each year a description of each reserve and explain what the purpose of that is.
Can I just
come
on? Just a very quick response to that. Dean's very kindly offered to take you through the detail of the budget, which would be really helpful for me. I just really love the idea of a smoothing reserve. I'm going to see if we can have one.
Just a comment really on page 46 on the institutions that we invest our money in. I mean, it's refreshing to see as a private authority that we actually invest our money in majority in A rated one way or another companies, and unlike some local authorities, my own included, where they tend to lend it out to other local authorities. It would be interesting, perhaps, Ian, if at some time you could give us an idea, unless I've missed it in the report, about there is something on page 47 about the percentage, but on the interest rates that you get back from these companies, it would be interesting to perhaps have a breakdown of that to see what profit, happy work that we make actually out of our investments.
Yeah, if it helps, we are required to do a thorough treasury management report, not only as part of the budget making process, but an interim one and a year-end one. So I had intended to take an interim treasury management report to the audit scrutiny in February, but I can make that widely available to all members if that would help, and include in that an indication of the interest rates.
Yes, Ken, thanks. Jane is absolutely right, and Nick Herder, as the Fire Minister, has several times challenged not just us, but the whole sector, as to, you've got all this money, what are you going to do with it? You could pay the firefighters' pay rise out of the capital that you've got. It's the stupidity of thinking that there's enough capital to cover revenue for the next 18 years, which there isn't. As if you could drill into it, we hold what the district auditor tells us we should hold, you do the same. Each of our five authorities are just the same. We only hold the minimum that we can, because we spend the money on essential services otherwise. And then, over the years, we've had some projects. And the rest of it is just, it's good housekeeping projects to try and eke the money out to do the best with it that we possibly can to keep Merseyside safe. You're absolutely right, these are messages that we can talk around this table, but there's ears not to hear further down the M6.
Just a few comments myself. I think when we set the budget last year, was a meeting management plan which takes us over the next 4 years. I think what was highlighted quite rightly is that those uncertainties that are built into that, and obviously interest rates, inflation, and Brexit, is obviously the three main ones. But the issue over the wage increases, book is ever published in the coming years. And with the last round of negotiations with the FBU and the overall 5% that was offered, which was rejected by the membership, we don't know what's happened with that since. It has gone a bit quiet, although there's still negotiations going on with the National NJC and the FBU. So we'll have to wait and see if things may change. It's obviously going to have further implications on us if there is a higher wage demand. And through ourselves and through AMFRA, one of the things that we did request is that if we were to fund the 2% and the government were to fund the 3%, then that should come solely from the government rather than from ourselves. Because if it did come from ourselves, then that extra 3% would equate to just over £1 million, I think it would be. Which would create more difficulty for us, which means we'd have to look at further cuts. And where we've got these reserves in place, I think it's disingenuous of the government to throw this back on us, because if we didn't have them to safeguard and protect the authority of the organisation, personally, I think we would have. So would any government wish any public sector, any public service to go bankrupt, especially one such as the Fire and Rescue Service, which is absolutely ridiculous. And they throw this back at us all the time, that we've got X amount of reserves, we've got this war chest that's there for us to use. And they're all identified, and all that money will be spent over the financial period. But, you know, I think it's wrong for the government to do that, because within the financial constraints, I think it's still where we should have 5% of our overall budget should be reserves, general reserves, and ours sits at 2 million. And I think that is under the 5% cap or threshold that has been suggested by the government. So we've actually got less of our general reserves than what we should be anticipating to have for. And the other thing that the government never say, they never ask us about our debt. How much is our debt? No, because we all have debts, all of the authorities have debt. But they never ask us about that. We're still not paying that back. But there you go, but just like on summer, but you know, to manage the finances the way it's being dealt with, and to be halfway through this financial year, to find ourselves in a better position than 100,000 there, is a bonus in a sense, but for that to be approved to go into the smooth reserves, that will help us in the event of any further sort of pay negotiations. And, you know, our thanks and appreciation to those at Ian. Item 5 is the Equality and Diversity Action Plan. Can we ask the Director to take us through the report?
Thanks, Chair. I'll turn to Mike Murray now. What this report relates to is an updated adult Equality and Diversity Action Plan between 2017, focused on 18 books, takes us up to 2020, and it particularly focuses on some of the progress that's been made. It also relates to the equality objectives that were set for 17-18 and beyond. So the first kind of thing I'll draw members' attention to is probably some of the examples of some of the work that we've been involved in over the course of the last 6 months. And they are captured from paragraph 6 onwards. So talking about some of the kind of great staff that have embraced some of the opportunities to tackle some of the inequality that exists across the Merseyside. I won't go into any particular detail there, other than to say we've kind of certainly focused around some of the kind of issues around Ramadan. We've also looked at issues around disability, around autism, and the introduction of the autism card alongside Merseyside Police. We've also responded, as you would expect, to Grenfell and Station Magic Room. We'll talk about it in a bit more detail later. But, you know, an ability to kind of communicate in a language which is accessible to all, and some of the work that we've done to respond as effectively as we possibly can to some of those challenges. Also, recognising the kind of challenges that face not just young people but the whole of the organisation, our mental health and wellbeing. We've extended some of that work into our youth engagement programmes. We've also, for the first time, which is applicable to release data around the equality gender pay gap. And again, probably first time in research in the UK to publish about part of pay policy. And we've done an extensive amount of work how we've engaged with the business community to support the business community again in reflecting of communicating in a way and a language which ensures that they are supported in the achievements and the maintenance of their compliance. And that's all underpinned by the community profiles that we've developed. So our staff, in whatever role that they have, understand the kind of different communities that exist across Merseyside, the different demographics, the different risk profiles, and the plans that we put in place from are reflective of that. As a result of that, Appendix 1 is, captures some of that work and some of it across the whole functional areas of the service and details the work that we've done to date. And then Appendix 2, which is on page 109, probably captures our equality objectives moving forward. And I will, if members will allow me, I will just kind of take you through what those equality objectives are, because things are important for us to understand. And equally, we've attached some metrics to how we will ensure that we are delivering against those particular quality objectives, because it's not necessarily as easy as one might think. The first quality objective is to create a strong and cohesive organisation, positive about rising to the future challenges we face, and that is about ensuring that the construction of the organisation is reflective of the communities we serve. The next one is to ensure that people from diverse communities receive equitable treatment to meet their needs. Our members will understand that some individuals who live in the Merseyside area, there is clear inequalities in regards to levels of income, disability, race, religion, so on and so forth. So ensuring equitable treatment is key to the delivery of the action plan. Reducing violent incidents among those particularly vulnerable groups. Again, we talk about older people who live in isolation, more susceptible to fires and fire deaths, and targeting our resources towards those particular inequalities is key moving forward. As is to just ensure that the organisation gives due regard to some of the kind of key elements of the Equalities Act around eliminating unlawful discrimination, harassment, victimisation, and so on, which is key and fundamental to the delivery of the service, but a service that functions and serves the community as effectively. And then finally, just kind of looking at the benchmarking of Merseyside Fire against some of the other organisations that exist, and looking at the benchmarking models that are available out to us to utilise and continue to achieve and aspire to excellence, and benchmark ourselves against the framework of some description, albeit work is still in progress through the LGA to see what that framework is. But members will understand we have the expectations coming to Merseyside in the future point in time, at which point then we'll look at how we are discharging our responsibilities. Do we know and understand the communities we serve? And are we rising to that challenge? And we will do that through the action plan and those equality objectives. And I'm happy to take any questions or any specific elements of that. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah, just a few comments I'd like to make on that. I mean, it is functional priorities on where we're at. It's just an excellent report. It just shows the length and breadth of the work that we do. And I'd just like to pick out, as we come to the end of the calendar year, I'd just like to pick out a couple of things that have been noted in there, but that I've been personally involved in throughout the year with different staff teams. And just to say that on page 84, or it's actually page 14 of the connected, under community risk management, certainly there was an opportunity for the members to go out into the Walton area only several weeks ago in the wake of a young adult who died in a fire, and the team went out there, advocates, cadets, volunteers, etc., just into the Walton area to check on home fire safety checks, to do them, and to replace or
renew or install smoke alarms and give advice. I was privileged to go along to that and see, and it never ceases to amaze me that the staff can get across the door, no matter what, you know, the respect that people in the community have for Merseyside Fire and Rescue Service, and they do openly call you in. Now, if we'd have had a cup of tea in every house that we went in, we wouldn't have got many fire alarms fitted, because people wanted to speak to you and they wanted to tell you a bit about stuff and why you've got a chip pan and why you haven't got a chip pan. Down to like, they got rid of the chip pan not because of the fire, risk of fire, but because of the putting weight on. And the staff were getting all this kind of stuff, but just, it might appear that I'm being flippant there, but I'm not. But on the day, I'm led to believe there's something like 124 domestic properties visited where smoke alarms and advice were given out. And out of that, we picked up 12 vulnerable individuals previously unknown. So that's a good move in itself, because again, it's all around the prevention. And this is the kind of stuff that we get criticised for by government staff. When they're issuing us with the grants and our budget, and it's basically you don't need as much money because you're not having as many fires. But the fact that we're doing a lot of work at the preventative end doesn't seem to be taken into account. But that was one thing that I went on. If I may just be quick on, there was recently a Safe and Well assurance and presentation given to Liverpool City Council's Social Care and Health Scrutiny Committee. The deputy Chief Fire Officer was there, Officer Phil Bain, and it was very, very well received at Liverpool. Because people didn't understand, yes, they do understand what the Fire and Rescue Service does, but what they didn't understand was the amount of work additional to putting fires out, getting you out the River Mersey, and cutting you out of a car. There's a hell of a lot more that goes on with partners, in partnership with others. So that was very, very well received. And some people have said to me, including the chair, we only wish we could have had them there for, well, we could have taken the whole of the night, because it was just so interesting. And it's that's the kind of thing that people out there don't know what happens behind the scenes. The other thing is, if I may, chair, is around the youth engagement that's mentioned in here. And I honestly do believe that our youth engagement is second to none from all the programmes and all the projects we actually run. But one in particular that I visited just recently with a Liverpool council colleague of mine, and it was the cadets, and it was the Archbishop Blanche cadets who run out of Kirkdale Fire Station. And we went along to speak to them, and we have got the only young women cadet unit in the country. And we've tried to, I've tried to get some publicity around that. But to sit and listen, and what them young women are achieving through the cadets, and to speak about what their future plans are, they were just amazing. And you look at them young women and you think, blimey, they're going places. They really are going places. But they absolutely loved being part of the cadets, going out into the community, doing work in the community. In some cases, probably better than some of their male counterparts, I've got to say. But we can't say who's better than who. But they were very, very impressive, them young women from Archbishop Blanche. So once again, and I know the school are very keen to keep that going. So I just thought it would be remiss of me if I didn't mention them a few things. So thanks, Chair.
Thank you, Jeff. Just going
2 weeks ago, we worked in Wirral in my ward. This time, just happened in other wards elsewhere. I'm sure it's happened in other areas in Merseyside. But working together with AGP on Big Doorknock, and clearly Merseyside Fire and Rescue were represented within that team of people going out. And again, what Peter was saying about identifying lonely people and people who we wouldn't normally come across and just don't open their door, whether it was because there was somebody in a fire service uniform or not, you know, we don't know. But just wondering where that information, how will that be captured into a report like this? And really, I've gone through it, but only quickly, but working with sort of the third sector charities and organisations and organisations is a big part, obviously, of what we do, and there are a number of them in here. I wasn't sure if AGK was actually mentioned or not, but it was a great exercise, and I say particularly from, you know, I was practicing, it was in my ward, and there was all the agencies that were doing the fire service before they were presented on that.
Chair, if you can, if we look at our kind of our target of our resources, you know, we are basing our target at this moment in time of people who are 65 and live alone, and that's utilising health data as much as anything else. So we know that the doors that we knock on, the big knock or the little knock, would get us access to particularly vulnerable individuals. But actually at the top of the pyramid is referring to some of the agencies. So the likes of Age Concern or Dementia Friends or people who are providing care in some way, shape or form, who understand what the risks and causal factors of a fire death across Merseyside are, they are at the pinnacle. So they are the ones that we want, you know, more than anything else. So those relationships are brought out to our prevention team, who work very, very closely with a number of agencies to ensure that we get those direct referrals in, and they are priority for us in regards to ensuring our safe and well business is conducted in those locations. And much the same as some of our firefighters going out and doing a home fire safety check, as soon as they have their personal and we will convey that on a check with the safe and well visit. So our target of resources is reassuring we get as effective as it's ever been whilst that being part of this organisation, and those available pathways to be part of the agencies are all robust and established. The bit that and the skill force is to ensure that we have a specific arrangement with the likes of Agency. If we identify someone who is vulnerable and isolated, we are able to defend and say Agency Concern so they can befriend that particular individual and support them way beyond the time that we have left.
Yes, thank you very quickly. We have, as directors of this organisation, a statutory responsibility to promote equalities and diversity. That's part of the legislation. And we should remind ourselves of that with a report of this. It's a 6-monthly report. But Merseyside Fire has always been, it's had it as one of its political objectives, maintaining ourselves as a very high level E&D operative within the fire sector, at least, if not the whole of local government. But also we've added into that now consideration of mental health, the mental health of our staff and of those that we deal with as well. And I know that it's a separate, it seems like a separate issue, but actually it is much the same. Our political objectives are to ensure that we are covering this and covering it well, and more recently we also wanted to have a focus on mental health and mental health issues.
Or assistance.
have information and data on them, then we can try and somewhat protect them as they put forward in the future. So the work we're doing is absolutely fantastic. And if you recall, it wasn't that long ago that we actually approved the plan. I think it was only the last thought of seeing it. So, you know, to get this feedback such early in the stage of implementing or approving the action plan is absolutely fantastic and a testament to all our staff involved with this. And I think, you know, it's a credit to them for the work that they're undertaking. And, you know, we should, if you would, you know, record our thanks to them. But when Peter mentioned that about the cadets, and the cadets are only fairly new to the authority. And when we attended the British Trust, and there's one of the cadets called Adam, and Phil, I hope he can explain a bit more. He is the one who received national recognition for work that he's undertaken as a cadet, and he's the first in the country. And he was invited to London to receive the certificate. Which he was excited because he would be, so he was excited to go to London to, you know, be presented with this certificate. And then I was in London, that. But he said it was a bit underwhelmed, should we say, because he got there and it wasn't as what he thought it would be, but it had this presentation and being invited up, be presented with this certificate by, it was by a member of parliament who was giving these certificates out to these young people who didn't turn up that day. So, you know, it just goes to show about what their commitment is to engage with young people and enthuse with young people and getting involved with other organisations. But do you want to just explain what that was?
Adam's an IWIL ambassador, and there are only 50 IWIL ambassadors across the whole of the UK, and he's been identified as a young people who've made a bit of a difference in performing social change and campaigning social action on a local level, and he's wrapped up on part of five cadets nationally, not just Merseyside specific. So groups of individuals who, from a multitude of backgrounds, carers, right through to scout leaders and so on and so forth, have been identified as playing a key, fundamental part in kind of getting young people a voice. And then, you know, there are young people taking that back and instilling that kind of ethos in other young people. And so we're very proud of the fact that Adam was selected as part of that group. And the chair has kind of alluded to that been taken down to London and being acknowledged in some way, shape, or form. And I know it's something that the chair wants to pursue here to maybe bring him in at one point to kind of recognise that more locally, or the fact that he's been identified for his contribution that he's making across Merseyside and across Merseyside fire cadets.
Thanks, Chair. Can I just mention also on the Prince's Trust? I've had now two or three occasions where I've gone, and one of the things I don't think we do enough is to publicise what we do with the Prince's Trust and what we succeed out of the Prince's Trust as well. And I think for what the fire workers here, the officers do with the young people, is absolutely amazing. I've had on one occasion where I attended one from Toxic, and he was a professional footballer in his own country. And then when he finished, I asked him, because I'm involved with children's football, would you like to come and volunteer? And that young guy come along every Wednesday evening and every Saturday and done with me. But the thing is, the officer brought him there and took it in because obviously he couldn't afford the bus fares, but we did offer to pay for them. But it's just amazing what the officers do with the young ones and how much they bring them out in 12 weeks. It is amazing to me. It blows me away. But I don't think we publicise what we achieve out of them.